So thank you very much, Diego, for all the nice words. And for the most part, they were exaggerated. It's always optimal to lower expectations and then to please everybody. And thank you for the invitation, and Banco de la República and the university. In fact, I have a very soft spot for Banco de la República because researchers from Banco de la República were the first ones to calibrate the model that I have co-created with this famous British professor, Charles Goodhart. And all of the literature, you can see it in my personal webpage, it is there. So, and I visited Colombia many times and Los Andes, but as a friend of mine who comes from Medellin told me, you left the best for the last, the part of it, that was Daira Estrada. So today what I'm going to do, I'm trying to talk about work that I've done with Anil Kasyap from Chicago and Alexandros Vardoulakis from the Federal Reserve Board in Washington, a former student, distinguished former student, and a current colleague of mine. And actually this work, as most of my work, the ones we're familiar with, is work with that started with Charles Goodhart. And in fact, some original papers on this area were co-authored with Charles Goodhart as well. The one I will present is available either in my webpage or as an NBR working paper, and basically talks about optimal bank regulation and in the presence of credit and run risk. And since I know that you have different backgrounds here, I'll try to go as slowly as I can, just communicate an idea of what we're doing with Anil Kasyap. And then throughout the talk, since I cannot be talking continuously, please interrupt me with questions.
Really?
Yes, please interrupt me as much as you can. Provided if you don't have any questions, that doesn't mean that things will be crystal clear. That means that you don't understand anything.
Huh?
No, in fact, I welcome questions, interruptions, and particularly disagreements.
Okay.
To agree with me, that's easy.
All right.
To disagree is more difficult. and despite the fact, don't be very aggressive, despite the fact that I supported England over Croatia, still, I still believe that Colombia was a better team than England. So, so be nice. So basically, is work that we tried to propose a model that will have financial intermediation, because traditionally models of macroeconomics and finance do not have a financial intermediation sector. And after the global financial crisis in 2008-2010, everybody basically realized how important it is to introduce a financial intermediation sector. Now, in order to motivate what sort of a financial intermediary we want to introduce in an otherwise classical and mainstream finance model will be an intermediary that will have the three primary activities and functions. In other words, to provide liquidity insurance. That's one of the primary purposes of any financial intermediation sector. Then also it is to provide and facilitate credit extension to fund savings to productive investments. That's a classic macroeconomic function of banks. And last but not least, to improve the risk sharing. Basically, this one is the contribution of the classic Diamond and Dybvig model that, as I was saying to my colleagues, when I was an undergraduate and a graduate student, even though one of the creators was at Yale, I had not read the model, but nevertheless, it's a very useful model to model and explain and rationalize liquidity provision. Then is a delegated monitoring, because banks can extend credit more credibly than the capital markets. And finally, under the presence of uninsured risks and shocks, we improve risk sharing. So the banks' asset portfolios, composition and structure based on liabilities interact to allow them to perform these services. However, these exact interactions, so the interactions, if you will, between the banking sector, the financial sector, and the real economy, may also be a source of fragility. In other words, may generate also pecuniary externalities. And what we are going to do for the rest of the day, we'll try to provide a model that basically will be able to perform exactly these three actions and examine how regulation can mitigate the externalities that emerge from the financial intermediation process. How do we do that? What is our framework? Our framework basically will be to have the Diamond and Dybvig model, which we modified to create an environment where the level of credit risk, whether the level of the credit risk and the credit and the risk from a bank run, which is the main source of risk in which is the main source of risk in a Diamond and Dybvig kind of framework, will coexist in an economy and endogenously determine and interact. So basically, we'll have an endogenous determination of runs via global gain. We have defaultable loans, and this is basically the main contribution that my work with Charles Goodhart, and in turn this work depends on the work of one of my supervisors, Martin Schubig, will have loans that are defaultable and they will fund a risky investment with uncertain liquidation value. So basically, this will open the door of having default and default premia and the externalities that are produced. Third, we have banks and people who obtain loans to be subject to limited liability. And then we assume that banks, basically financial intermediaries, have a comparative advantage and they economize on monitoring costs. And bankruptcy costs is basically the marginal cost of default, make default costly. And what we basically established, that the private equilibrium features excessive levels of lending relative to liquid asset holdings and more debt financing as compared to equity financing. Therefore, and the key trade-off that will be basically underline our model will be the trade-off between the risk of a bank run that creates underinvestment, because that risk will deter investors and that will create underinvestment, versus the limited liability that, on the other hand, creates the incentive for excessive risk taking and over leveraging. So the underinvestment between the credit, between the run risk and versus the incentive for excessive risk taking is the main trade-off that our model will possess. Please observe that the probability of a bank run, the probability of the possibility of a bank run destroys resources, creates a deadweight loss, and in other words, basically you can think of it as an incentive to discourage risk taking, because the concept of a bank run, which is the ultimate melting down of a financial intermediary, it is tantamount and equivalent to having a high default penalty. And we will establish that if we want to improve the welfare, because in the end of the day we do economics, so welfare is something that we care, we need at least two regulatory tools are needed to implement planning outcomes. So our framework, basically, that's what we are trying to achieve, and these are the deviations from an otherwise standard Diamond and Dybvig model, and how we will embed this Diamond and Dybvig model to a standard general equilibrium framework. I know we are all experts in Diamond and Dybvig, but where I come from, we say repetition is the mother of all knowledge. So let us summarize, because that's important, how we deviate from the Diamond and Dybvig. Please recall that what we have in the Diamond and Dybvig model, the classic Diamond and Dybvig model, we have a riskless loan that is funded by deposits, and then we have Diamond and Dybvig preferences. So in other words, we have an idiosyncratic shock to the preferences, and then we have basically a sunspot kind of situation where we'll have a multiplicity of equilibrium, and there will be a possibility of a bank run that's totally random and a possibility of no bank run, which is equally random. And then in the case of a no bank run, some of the Diamond Dybvig investors would like to liquidate early their investments, and the other ones will wait to have a certain investment outcome in the future. So this is the plain vanilla kind of Diamond Dybvig that is the main workhorse to explain liquidity provision via financial intermediation. Now, what do we do? First, we introduce a risky investment that is funded both by deposits as well as equity. Then we have the same type of investors. We have the idiosyncratic preference shocks, or we have Diamond Dybvig liquidity shocks. So a priori example, you don't know whether you will be a patient or an inpatient investor. And then we also have now uncertain liquidation value. And then we have the possibility of a bank run, of not having a bank run, and a bank run. And the key deviation, and that's what makes our model and has taken 3 years to write and rewrite, revise and revise, in fact, it's 3 years and a half, is that basically the bank runs depend on the fundamentals. So whether a bank run will occur depends on the fundamental of the real economy. So in other words, what we do, please observe the philosophy of what we do, we try to bring bank finance to the real economy. We try to have a real interaction between the nominal and the real sector of the economy. And in order to do that, we use the result and the technique that has been introduced by a very good paper by Itai Goldstein and Pausner of Penn. And then in the third period, we have an uncertain investment outcome and the investment payoff. So unlike the Diamond Dybvig, will have states of nature, a good state of nature that the investment outcome will be high versus a state of nature that the investment outcome will be low. And we also have investment monitoring loans and deposits repayments happening at the end. And please observe that the loan and deposit repayments will be defaultable. So that's another deviation from the classic Diamond Dybvig. So what we really do from an economics point of view, in the classic Diamond Dybvig model, we put the model into a general equilibrium, but because we want to study the interaction between the real and the nominal sector. How do we break the classical dichotomy between the real and the financial sector? By introducing the probability of the run depending on the fundamentals. And finally, we have default premium. That's why the title is credit and run risk. We have the possibility of a bank run occurring, but also we have defaultable liabilities, defaultable assets and liabilities. Deposits are defaultable and loans are also defaultable. So basically that's how our model looks like. Let's be now more precise about our economy. We have entrepreneurs that own rights to a project and borrow to implement it. So we have also agent heterogeneity. We have savers that invest in bank deposits and also hold some liquidity. So they also solve an investment problem. And finally, we have the bankers that contribute bank equity, admit deposits from the savers, and make risky loans to entrepreneurs. And finally, they are allowed also to invest in the safe liquid asset. So basically, this is what the three agents are, and at T equals 2, what do the guys do? Basically, depositors learn their type, whether they are patient or inpatient. This is consistent with the Diamond Dybvig literature, and they receive a noisy signal. They receive a noisy signal about the realization of the liquidation value of their loans, which will be C from lower bar and upper bar. Yes, doesn't work the way I want. Okay, and they receive the noisy signal. in the probability if a run happens in a run, basically the savers, they will receive their deposits with a probability of theta that is endogenously determined. So the probability of recouping your loans will be endogenously determined. And if the bank survives, then basically it uses the liquid assets and some loans to serve early withdrawals. So that's basically what's happening in period number two. And I have to note here that the idiosyncratic shocks in the intermediate period to consume early or late, and you have a percentage of early to be fixed, but shocks are private information and cannot be hedged. Moreover, unlike many of the models in finance, our bankers are concave in the first period, so they have risk aversion in the first period, and they're neutral in the second, they're risk neutral linear at equals 2 and at equals 3. The savers, they're concave at equals 1 and at equals 2, and risk neutral in the last period. Finally, the entrepreneurs are concave at equals 1 and at equals 2, and linear at equals 3. The last bit, the last bit at equals 3, what happens? Basically, we learn about the productivity shock, so we learn whether we are in the good state of nature or in the bad state of nature, because remember, in the modification of our Diamond Dybvig model, we have assumed that then the investment payoff is uncertain, and then with probabilities, the probabilities are exogenously given omega 3 good or bad, and the bank decides whether or not to monitor the investment. Finally, the entrepreneurs and the banks decide whether to default, the entrepreneurs on their loans and the banks on their deposits. So this is, in a nutshell, our model. And now what we are going to do, we are going basically to go slowly over all these maximization problems. So this is the standard maximization problem of the saver. This is utilities, von Neumann modulus and utility. And here we have the utility of period one, and then for stage two, for periods two and three, is the expected utility of having a run versus not having a run, and the integrals with respect to which we do our analysis is the psi lower bar, psi star, and psi star, which is the threshold value from which the liquidation value of loans determines, determines whether or not we'll have a run. And then the probability of a run occurring, you realize because this is endogenously determined. So the probability of a run not only is endogenous, but also depends on the fundamental, as we will see later. We'll see later on. And now, what are the budget constraints? Period one, basically, you have to have the consumption is equal to your endowment minus your investment in deposits and the liquidity asset. If a run occurs, then a depositor, regardless whether it's impatient or patient, this is the amount that he receives. And this is the indicator function that basically the saver is paid, because the probability of recouping your loan is again endogenously determined. If a run does not, does not occur, then the impatients withdraw and the patients wait. So these are the corresponding budget constraint. Finally, the patient depositors will reveal their tithe truthfully in equilibrium. In other words, this kind of incentive compatibility constraint is valid. Then, out of this, and that's a key thing, out of this kind of optimization problem, one can derive the deposit supply schedule from the savers. This is the first order conditions that basically all what it says besides is just taking the Lagrange multiplier of this subject to the constraints, and the savers basically equate marginal utility of lost consumption today versus the expected marginal utility that they will benefit from holding the deposits in the future. In the case that we have a run, the savers here, in the case that we have a run, the savers will withdraw, and their marginal utility depends on their type and the probability theta that's endogenously determined that they will be repaid. If, on the other hand, the run does not occur, then the impatient savers are fully repaid at the promised rate, 1 plus the deposit rate at period 2, while the patient savers would do not withdraw, receive the uncertain deposit payoff, V, 3SD, 1 plus R, 3D, minus any bankruptcy cost. So this, basically, that's the new thing that we introduced that basically has, that justifies the endogenous default in the sense that the repayment of the banks is a choice variable. So basically, default is not a random variable, but it's an economic variable, it's a macro variable that banks decide in equilibrium. So, and that's a very big thing in all of the literature we have with Kasyap and Goodhart, that default probabilities is a macroeconomic variable. It's determined endogenously in equilibrium, and positive default is compatible and consistent with the orderly function of the markets. In effect, there is some sort of a, if you want, some sort of a marginal utility, marginal benefit, marginal cost first order condition that you weigh the benefits and the cost of default. Because the individual saver is very small, then the probability that they will be repaid, as long as the probability that deposits will be paid to them, they take them as given. So we have a competitive assumption there, and we abstract away of the difficulties of calculating game theoretic moral hazards between any two agents. So we have a competitive assumption. So that's the deposit supply, and then now we go to the banker's optimization, to the banker's optimization problem. Now, the banker's optimization problem, again, you have the probability of a no run. If there is a run, they do not care, and that's basically the main externality that the bank generates in the model, that if there is no run, then they maximize the expected sum of their dividends, and they satisfy their balance sheet constraints. However, if a run occurs, they don't care. So they do not internalize the externality of a run. And that's what is the first divergence from the competitive equilibrium. At equals one, the balance sheet constraint is investments, liquidity equals deposits and equity. In a run, deposits are paid according to a sequential service constraint, and the probability of the payment is liquid assets, deposits one plus the deposit rate, liquidation value times investment. And if the bank survives, after learning the liquidation value, it liquidates part of its loans to serve early withdrawals. And this is basically the ratio that determines as a function of the number of the impatient investors, how many loans it will liquidate. Then we have the dividends at equals three, given survival and after the productivity shock, either or after the state of nature, either good or bad, is realized to be percentage of repayment times remaining loans and the loan rate minus percentage of repayment, late deposits and the deposit rates. So this is basically accounting, flow of funds equations that follow common sense. The percentage of repayment loans, so basically now you have not only the bankers deciding how many of the deposits to give back, but you also have the investors that they're deciding how much of their loans to return to the banks. And the two of them interact to find the probabilities of default. And it's the minimum of one versus the ratio of production in state 3S, so the productivity shock that is realized in state in period three over the outstanding contractual loan obligations. If bankruptcy, in bankruptcy depositors are repaid on a pro rata base and the percentage repayment, so this is the repayment rate of deposits is again one versus the value of assets in state 3S over the outstanding contracted deposit obligations. Please observe that from the definition of the repayment, the deposit repayment rate, the dividends are strictly positive whenever the repayment rate is 1 and 0 otherwise. So that's in order to be consistent with optimization. So that's, and yes?
The model has 3 interest rates, right?
Yes, loans.
Loans and 2 and the 2 deposit
rates. Exactly. The
so what's the question? Is there any, does the model brings any connection between, what is
the connection? They are connected, but so basically what you have in mind is what I had in mind, and I hope that I could do that, to have some sort of a yield curve, a maturity structure of the interest rate. It is very erratic. I cannot basically analytically solve for that. They are connected, that's for sure, because there is a liquidity premium, there is a default premium, and there is also the run risk, basically I cannot find a consistent analytical relation between the two of them. Good point. I thought of that. Actually, what I want to do, I want to take this argument to extend a little bit further in the future to have some sort of a yield curve that is affected by the run risk. By the default risk, we can do it. But the run risk, because there is a discontinuity, is a much more difficult thing. So we said the dividends for sure. So now.
I have a question.
Yes.
You're assuming that banks don't care about bank runs, or
they no, no.
problem
No, no, they care and very much so. Actually, it's even worse than that. Because, you know, we spend a year, because it's one thing to have, I want to say this a little bit later, but it's okay, better now that we're less tired. Now, in fact, it's even worse. Of course they do care about runs. And the runs depend on the fundamentals, but they also are aware that they affect, their behavior affects the probability of a runs. However, if a run occurs, then there is no first order condition. So the problem of the whole model, initially we got the plain vanilla Goldstein-Pausner, and we said we are home free. We submit the paper to this excellent journal, I won't tell you which, and then they told us, aha, are you telling me that the runs depend on the fundamentals? However, the banks, they do not realize that their behavior affects the probability of a run. Do it this way. That was 7 months. Not easy at all, because to put this global game damn thing in general equilibrium is difficult. Why? Because all of these global games are binary games, are 0-1. And whenever you put discontinuous things in general equilibrium, hell breaks loose. It's not easy to do it. It's not a coincidence that people had not put all of this global game literature into general equilibrium. It was tough. So then we proceed, and banks choose their risky loans. Banks choose their risky loans, liquid assets, and equity contribution E, the run threshold X star, and the deposit contract they offer. They offer a deposit contract, and then the depositors decide how much to deposit. So there is some sort of monopolistic power of the banks. So another issue that causes problems in the maths of the thing. So, and basically, they maximize their utility, their profits, subject to their balance sheet. Now, that's exactly the problem, that the bank understands how the actions matter for the probability of a run, determine a global game, by the global game equation that we're going to show later. Moreover, the banker understands how his actions affect the incentives to monitor after the uncertainty is resolved. And there is the incentive compatibility constraint that the dividends will be greater or equal than some exogenously given private benefit. Finally, the banker chooses the optimal deposit contract on the deposit supply offered by depositors, and contracts may be comprehensive, all bank choices may be contractible or incomplete, only the amount of deposits and interest rates are contractible. That we can do it any way we see fit. This way we have the loan supply curve that basically, again, you do the maximization, you take first order conditions, and we parameterize the model. That's the only tricky business. These are the psi's, not psi's. You may disagree with anything I say, not with this. It's psi, not psi. Where I come from, I know this. So these are the Lagrange multiplier of the balance sheet, the incentive compatibility constraint, the global gain and the deposit supply curve. We parameterize the model such that the entrepreneur and the banker default in the bad state for all liquidation values to make our life easy. So in the bad state, we all default. Due to limited liability, as I said before, the banker only internalizes states that he is solvent, and the Psi's are the shadow cost of investments, and the banker internalizes how investment choices affect incentives to monitor and the probability of a run. She also internalizes the effect of deposit supply if contracts are comprehensive, i.e. if the indicator function is one, whereby PsiDS is the corresponding multiplier. Now, the liquid asset holdings basically, again, I do exactly the same thing, and the optimal choice is governed by the same considerations like the credit extension choices. However, here we have to know that the marginal returns on the liquid assets are scaled by the liquidation value, because the bank needs to liquidate one over C number of loans to serve early withdrawals. And since the liquidity risk for C cannot be perfectly hedged, the banker will hold positive liquid assets. Here, basically, when we say liquidity, what we mean is like borrowing against the bank run, and in other words, that's a source of incompleteness. So we have many sources of incompleteness. One source is the Diamond Dybvig consumers, that they do not know themselves whether they will be patient or impatient. Here also is about the probability of a run.
What do you mean by positive liquid assets?
I mean some carryover liquid technology. I put some assets into my vault. It's like required reserves, if you will. And actually this will play a role later on when I start doing regulation. That helps. Because now already I have two sources of market incompleteness. Contributed equity, basically the contributed equity. Here, again, I do injecting more equity. Basically, that necessitates banker to sacrifice consumption in the initial period. And basically, this first order condition determines the shadow cost of the balance sheet, which is inversely related to the amount of equity that the banker puts in the bank. In banking models, and that's the main thing, without endogenous default risk, the higher funding costs or injecting more equity would lead to higher loan rates and lower investments. However, when equity changes the level of credit extension, this doesn't necessarily need to hold as the case is in our model. In other words, higher equity and cost funding can be compatible with lower interest rates and higher investment levels. Now, the run threshold, which is basically what the global game gives you, the banker will choose the run threshold or the probability of a run that is given by Q, solving this first order condition, and the banker balances the reduction basically in dividends because of marginally higher run threshold Xi star against the effect of relaxing the global game constraint and the incentive compatibility. So that's how the bank finds the threshold over which he will run. The bank run will happen. So basically that's a key thing that's endogenously determined, and that's not very easy. When you do the calibration, as you see the example later on, that's not very easy to pin down and have nice results. Finally, this is what describes, with respect to the banker, the deposit contract, that basically the banker will choose the banker will choose a combination of the second period deposit rate, third period deposit rate, and deposits demands, so that these are the three budget, three threshold conditions that determine, and as before, the banker internalizes only the good state and not the bad state, because in the bad state, he will be insolvent and you have limited liability. Also, he considers the choice of the deposit contract, how the deposit contract affects the savers' deposit supply, even if the contracts are not complete. Moreover, since the guy is monopolistic, he internalizes how investment, liquidity, and equity affect deposit supply curves, even when IC is zero. The last thing that I want to say about the banker is basically that he has his own equity and will choose the loan contracts, the interest rate, and the credit extension level to maximize her utility subject to the loan supply offered by the bank. We know that the entrepreneur is protected by limited liability and may default if a run does not occur. He's aware of that. In Iran, the entrepreneur continues to produce using her own endowments and consumes the proceeds of his investments. Therefore, this basically is the loan supply curve offered by the bank, and the entrepreneur takes how many loans will be liquidated and the threshold as given, because she's because is perfectly competitive. The planner recognizes all of those things depend on the aggregate bank portfolio. So you see here all the wedges that start emerging. The last guy, who is the simpler guy, if you will, the simpler guy to analyze is basically the entrepreneur. The entrepreneur basically has the optimal choice of the loans and yields the following loan demand. And the first two terms correspond to the entrepreneur's profits coming from the difference between the marginal product and the interest rate payments. And the last term captures the dependence of the interest rates on the level of the loan, because our banker is not perfectly competitive. Introducing now the global game. Now introducing the global game in a Diamond and Dybvig. Is due, as I said, to Goldstein and Pausner. That's a very good paper. It's one of the best extensions of the Diamond and Dybvig, and there are thousands of them. The bank is only funded with deposits, and the liquidation value is fixed. Moreover, they have private signals on the on the probability of the good productivity shock, whether I'll be very productive or not very productive, because all of these models in the global games, you have to condition on a shock. So Goldstein and Pausner, they condition the productivity shock. And it determines the likely value of deposits in the third period. The lower dominant region is very easy to establish for low productivity shocks. And the upper dominant regions comes from an external agent who values investment over and above its liquidation value. So the Goldstein and Pausner is kind of a, it's a very straightforward exercise. However, we do something way more complicated, and that's at equals two. Depositors receive a private signal regarding the liquidation value of their risky asset, where the signal is uniformly distributed. The run threshold, as the epsilon goes to zero, is given by this global game, equation. So you have to solve this to find the run threshold xi star over which you'll maximize your dividends per share. Then theta star is the highest number of depositors running, such that the bank doesn't fold over. And this is what gives you the ratio. Liquidity assets, liquid assets that you have under the belt. So these are your required, your buffer, if you will. Xi star times investment, and then deposit obligations one plus the deposit rate. So, therefore, unlike Goldstein and Pausner, that more or less the upper and lower dominance are established basically exogenously by the realization of the productivity shocks. In our case, they are endogenously determined. The upper dominance threshold of never run is easy and is described by this, but the lower dominance threshold always run is given by this equation, even the impatient cannot be fully paid. This comes because the bank always plans to liquidate to repay some depositors. So, and we have two types of risks in this game. We have the fundamental run risk, and we have the total run risk. The fundamental run risk is the lower dominance minus xi lower bar, as opposed to the total run risk, which x star minus x lower. So this is the risk. This is the fundamental run risk that comes from the real economy, as opposed to this is both the financial shock as well as the real shock. So pretty much, that's how we have modeled the game. Now the fun starts. Let us summarize now the externalities I've managed to put in my model. What are the externalities that I've managed to introduce in my model? Banks, obviously, they are tempted to exploit limited liability, therefore to over-leverage, even though they recognize that by exploiting limited liability, they increase the probability of a bank run and consequently the deadweight loss to the economy. Because they optimize only over the states that they are solvent. And because they have limited liability, they don't care about the states they are not. Savers and borrowers, atomistic, and they take threshold variables, repayment rates, and all of the banker's choices as given. So they will make the same choices, and collectively this determines the composition of the bank's asset and liability mix. Therefore, we have two distorted margins in the first order conditions. First margin is a distorted asset mix of loans and liquid assets, so they don't line up as they would otherwise do in an otherwise perfect capital market, and a distorted liability mix of equity and deposits. So these two distortions, these two wedges, basically drive most of the inefficiency of the model. And of course, all of these things can be seen, these two distorted margins, the asset mix of loans and liquid assets, and the liabilities mix of equity and deposits can be seen for the first order conditions. So in order to be able now to do welfare analysis, we have to define the second welfare theorem. So we have to define the objective function of the social planner. However, as I have told you, here I have incompleteness. The diamond dybvig incompleteness, liquidation value of the loans that I cannot hedge, and the shocks. Therefore, it's very difficult to model the constrained Pareto social planner from the second welfare theorem. So what do I do? And that's something that many people like. What we do, we don't take a position, we're neutral. So we create that the social planner chooses allocation and prices to maximize the weighted sum of the objective functions of the entrepreneur, the saver, and the banker. And the planner is constrained by the market structure, so you respect the balance sheet of the bank and the budget constraints of the entrepreneur and the saver, the global game and the incentive compatibility constraints, and the loan demand and supply schedules by the entrepreneur and the saver. However, unlike Arrow-Debré economies, these W's basically are arbitrarily chosen. So whether I care as a planner about the entrepreneur, about the banker, about the saver, that it depends on the policymaker. For example, if I am Trump, I don't care about savers, I don't care about bankers, I care only about the entrepreneurs. If I am Maduro, I suppose I care only about savers. And I assume that I am the only saver in the economy. Now, in other economies, I care about all the entrepreneurs, the savers, and the bankers. So what we do, the results we do, we take grids of all possible combinations. So we don't take positions, political economy positions, about whom we care. Now, to see the asset mix distortions, basically we combine the investment and the liquid asset optimality conditions. So we go to the first order conditions. And to see the liabilities, and to see the liability mix, we combine the equity and the deposits first order conditions. And what do we do? The first experiment we do as good economists, we compare the private and the social investment liquidity margins in detail so that to see how the competitive solution differs from the social planner's solution. Here you see the banker's investment liquidity margins, the privately optimal investment liquidity margin will weigh the contributions of an additional unit of investment versus an additional unit of liquid assets on bank profits, on run probability, on the incentives of bank to monitor it, sorry, that's the run probability, and on the deposit supply for comprehensive contracts. So that's how I study the investment liquidity margin. The planner's investment liquidity margin, though, we have here these things that we wouldn't otherwise have. The planner considers the direct effect of a portfolio shift from liquid assets to risky loans. And the planner also internalizes how picking the run threshold and how relaxing the banker's incentive compatibility constraint and how moving along the deposit supply curve affects entrepreneurs' and savers' welfare. So the planner internalizes, in so many words, how the choices of investment and liquidity affect deposit supplies and loan demands and deposit supplies, irrespective of contract comprehensiveness. So basically, you see that this is what the social planner solves for, as compared to the private one, that you care only about bank profits, run probabilities, and you don't care about the interactions. Regulatory ratios now that we investigate, because now we have to find, we see the distortion in theory, and you'll see the numbers. Hopefully that will make the picture more clear. And then, given that we see the distortion, we say now, how can we use regulatory tools, regulation, to retrieve the social planner's choice? And the capital measures, the capital tools, the regulatory tools that we use the capital ratio, number one, then number two, we use the leverage ratio, liquidity coverage ratios, and net stable funding ratios. And basically, these are the tools that characterize, for the most part, the new Basel Accord. So that's basically, we see here, we compare the private equilibrium, the competitive equilibrium, versus the social planner for weights WE and WS, 0.2 and 0.6. So basically, 0.2 goes to the entrepreneurs, 0.6 is the weight for the savers, and the balance 0.2 for the bankers. Here's 0.4, so this more of a kind of a Keynesian government. This is more of a centrist government, 0.4, 0.4, and I don't care about the bankers. And these weights are the Trump weights that I care only about the entrepreneurs. And what do we observe? From this part, so basically planner corrects the distortion in the asset mix and chooses more liquidity. So you see, in all cases, that the planner chooses more liquidity in order to correct the distortion of the asset mix. Moreover, the planner here corrects the distortion in the liabilities mix by choosing more capital. So you see here, in all cases, he chooses more capital. And with respect to investments, that's the tricky bit, that the planner may choose higher or lower investments, but total assets are always higher. Regardless, the more stable asset and funding choices of the planner are driven by each wish and desire to lower the run probability and the fundamental run probability. So the main thing that the planner wants to correct for to control for is to lower here the probability of a bank run in the private equilibrium is 0.4, and regardless whether or not he cares about bankers, entrepreneurs, or savers, he wants to reduce both the run probability and the fundamental run probability. So, lesson number one, the planner wants to correct the main externality of the model, which is the probability of a bank run occurring. The lower run risk, now, if I try to study now what is happening with respect to welfare, whose welfare does the planner wants to favor, the lower run risk is beneficial for both the entrepreneur and the saver. Now, the person who is getting hurt by the planner's behavior is, guess what, is the banker. He was already internalizing what mattered to her in the private equilibrium. But total welfare, if you see the total welfare, is always higher. So, in other words, the banker, since we saw from the first order conditions, has a more complicated problem to solve, and therefore has more degrees of freedom to transfer the externalities of the run and default away from its balance sheet to the entrepreneur and the saver. And that's exactly what the social planner tries to correct. He tries to stop this effort of the planner, of the banker, to park the deadweight loss and the externality of the run to the real sector of the economy and to the savers. Moreover, the mix of capital and liquidity depends on the agent that the planner favors. Finally, if the entrepreneur is favored, the planner chooses more capital and less liquidity. So here you see that the entrepreneur is favored. The planner he's using, the planner will use more capital here, 0.32, as compared to 0.31 in the competitive equilibrium, and less liquidity from the private equilibrium. So that's how basically the planner operates. Now, after we have done this, let us try to see what sort of regulatory tools we are going to use to implement in a competitive economy the planner solution. And now this exercise is very difficult. Let me make a detour and remind us the main theorem, the main intuition of the theorem of Stiglitz and Newberry, that said if I have an incomplete markets economy, then the equilibrium is not only second best, obviously, since some assets are missing and some risk cannot be hedged. The equilibrium is not only second best, but it's third best. Translation. By using income transfers via taxation or subsidies, I can improve the welfare of everybody involved. And this theorem was formally proved in a famous paper by John Giannakopoulos, my other supervisor, and Heracles Polymarchakis in the 80s, whereby they improved exactly this. Now, what am I trying to do here now? I'll try to do exactly the same, to replicate the Giannakopoulos-Polymarchakis theorem. However, I won't use transfers. Because transfers is very easy. It's like taking money from one person, giving to another, or taxing. So basically, you play around with the marginal utilities of every agent in the economy. You try to find the gradients that improve everybody, and you're all set. Now I will play with their constraints. And that's a difficult exercise. Instead of picking up the marginal utilities, I play with the budget sets, and I hope that the marginal utilities will line up the right way. So, question number one, can I use one tool to do this business?
I don't think so.
The punchline, no, I'll tell the punchline at the end, the theoretical punchline of this work. Let's assume that I'm a good student and I'll try to do it one by one. So I don't know the Stiglitz-Newberry, I don't know Giannakopoulos-Polymarchakis, and I don't know something else I will say at the end. So I say, let's try to do now capital regulation. And I take the intermediate case, 0.4, 0.4, and I increase the capital regulation. You see, the private equilibrium, I see the probability of a run falls. The probability of fundamental run falls, but still, I cannot replicate the planner's solution. I see that investment increases because I had the problem of underinvestment. And the trade-off is this higher shadow funding cost versus the pecuniary externalities of Iran and demand for liquidity. I see also that the entrepreneurs and the savers are better off. Both of them are better off, but the banker is considerably worse off. So capital regulation, however, favors the entrepreneur more so than the social planner. On the other hand, liquidity is lower. No. Why did I say the liquidity? Oh, here you go. The liquidity is lower than the planner solution. Finally, the capital ratio overshoots what the planner would have done. Therefore, basically, you correct part of the externality of the run and you create various distortions between the savings and investments. Let's do leverage ratios. That's similar, basically. The leverage ratios are similar to the capital requirements. So leverage and capital, more or less, they go together. So in other words, what happens? Similar, and you have the restricting leverage in order to restrict the probability of Iran that, again, it goes down. And you push the investments up. And contrary to the capital requirements, higher investment, you reduce basically the liquid assets. The Iran does not improve, but the fundamental probability of Iran becomes more likely. Finally, more investment helps the entrepreneur, but it marginally hurts the saver. So alone, basically, the leverage regulation is not beneficial, but as you will see shortly, is very beneficial when it is used with other tools. Now, one note that the bank has only on-balance sheet assets. So that's a big thing that most of the banks, they have subsidiaries and all that, is not considered because leverage basically is used to control for the off-balance sheet assets. So therefore, in that respect, we're not very favorable about leverage precisely for the reason that all of our assets are on the balance sheet. However, you will see still the leverage ratio is useful under certain requirements. The next thing I do is liquidity coverage ratio regulation. There, in the liquidity coverage regulation, when I increase the liquidity, we see again that the probability of Iran is decreasing. So no matter what, everything is trying to hit the main externality of this model, which is the probability of Iran. So the Diamond Dybvig intuition is quite powerful. However, now we have spiced up the Diamond Dybvig intuition with the deposit default risk and the loan default risk, and the pecuniary externalities from the trade, which Diamond and Dybvig do not have. Yet, the bank run externality is quite serious. Here we see the investment decreasing. We see the improvement, the liquidity coverage ratio improves, and the entrepreneur and the saver. Of course, it hurts the banker, but it also helps the saver relatively to the social planner. Finally, that's the social planner, that's the saver. Finally, it overshoots the planner's solution. Net stable funding ratio, which is now another thing that is very trendy nowadays. It basically says the net stable funding ratio is the same thing, like almost the same thing like liquidity coverage ratio. You have decreased investment, run probability falling, equity decreasing, and you have entrepreneurs and savers benefiting. Again, the banker is going down, but most of the benefit go to the saver. But if less weight is put on stable deposit funding, then the net stable funding ratio, and we have done that pretty much, is like capital regulation. Summary of what we have done so far. Still, the punchline is not around. The summary is that all regulations reduce the probability of a run, and they have beneficial welfare effects for the saver and entrepreneur and detrimental effects for the banker. The probability of a run occurs because of bad fundamentals also drops, but does not go to zero. So you don't want to eliminate the probability of a run. You cannot eliminate the probability of a run. And why do bankers do worse? Because they are prevented for exploiting the clause of limited liability. In other words, to ignore the deadweight loss that they cause in the bad state of nature. Capital and leverage regulations produce higher investments and favor primarily the entrepreneur, where liquidity regulations lower investments and they favor the saver. Now, implementing the solution of the planner. No single regulation, because can replicate the planner solution, because the planner wants more liquidity and lower investment than what capital regulations deliver alone, and he wants more capital and more investment than what the liquidity regulations deliver alone. And this comes from the two distorted margins. So, in other words, two tools are needed to be combined together to implement the planner solution, given that there are two distorted margins. And the tools we use, it's not a unique pair of tools, is basically we cannot use liquidity coverage ratio and net stable funding ratio cannot be used jointly, and capital regulation and the leverage ratio cannot be used jointly, subject to the observation we have made that we don't have off-balance items. What we can do, we can use capital regulation combined with either net stable funding ratio and liquidity coverage ratio, or the leverage combined again with liquidity coverage ratio or net stable funding ratio. So these two pairs basically can replicate the social planner's solution. And the upshot of the story is the old Timbergen rule. The very same way that in the old times when you were doing monetary and fiscal policy, you would say you need as many tools as policy goals you have. So likewise here, where you correct your externalities, you need as many tools as many externalities you want to correct for. So the Timbergen rule applies for regulation as well. So when you have this sort of type of models, you have to be careful because the private equilibrium features excessive levels of lending, so you over-leverage relative to liquid assets, and more debt financing relative to equity financing. A capital tool and a liquidity tool are complements. They are not substitutes. They can be used complementary and are both needed to implement the planner solutions, given that there are two externalities that are produced by the distorted margins. However, all of these things we do, they are subject to the political economy kind of considerations, in other words, to the weights that you put to the saver, entrepreneur, and the bankers. And that's the idea of the complements versus substitutes. The key thing is that capitals and liquidity are complements and are both needed to implement the planner solutions. And that summarizes what we have done, that basically the main takeaways of this thing is the run risk is important, the default risk is also important, they generate two distorted margins, and therefore you need more than one regulatory tool. And the pair of regulations that you are going to use depends on your political economy considerations. So it's not a matter of more regulation, it's a matter of the correct regulatory mix that one has to implement. Thank you.
Now we're going to give you the opportunity to ask questions, Professor Tsomocos.
Donald Trump is trying to ease the regulation that Obama made after the crisis. What do you think about that?
Tell me again.
Donald Trump is trying to ease the regulations that Obama's government took after the crisis. What do you think about that?
I don't think very well about Donald Trump in general. I mean, it's not only about the regulations. On the one hand, he's trying
to ease
the regulations. On the other hand, he tries to put tariffs and quotas all over the world. So that's a sign of a psychological dichotomy here. Now,
but for the banking industry, I mean.
Well, I'll give you a historical example. The person who basically put to rest the famous Glass-Steagall regulation, in fact, who neutralized the Glass-Steagall regulation, it was Bill Clinton. And you see what happened quite soon after this thing was finished. The crisis arrived. So, if I have externalities, missing financial markets, moral hazard considerations, example, credit default swaps, it is insane to allow markets to operate unregulated. The question is to discuss what type of regulation, but not to ease regulation, because the market somehow, with a Scotsman's hand, will pick the right prices. I think no serious economist agrees with that, only if he's in the Council of Economic Advisors of Trump. I don't think this, and I think nobody agrees with him.
But do you think it's good for economy or bad?
No, bad. Bad, because as you see here, you're talking about welfare. I could very easily put a production function here. And then you will see the disastrous effects of default and run risk. I understand that bank runs happen quite rarely, but they happen. And when they happen, they didn't cause what we saw 2008, 2010. Then you have also collateral damage, which is the Eurozone debt crisis, which basically has destroyed the entire Southern Europe and has put in danger the entire Eurozone exercise. So it is terrible for the economy. It's better to go slow but steadily growing rather than to take all of these risks that may destroy the whole edifice as well. Because the banking system, and that's why the entire academic literature now, they recognize the fact that the main deficiency of the old models was that they did not have a banking system. The banking system is crucial in whatever central banks are doing, governments are doing, investors are doing, and savers are doing.
How do you consider that your results can change if you include the deposit insurance on your model?
The referee asked for that. That's the obvious question to ask, but if you have deposit insurance, then, now I have a proof. In the old times, I would say exactly the same thing, but I didn't have a proof. See what happened with the European Banking Union, with the European Banking Union in Europe. Deposit insurance is not money dropping from the sky. Fiscal transfers are needed, allocation of risks are needed, conditionality is needed. All of these things have welfare effects as well. We definitely have to do this. We have to put deposit insurance in these sort of models, but don't think that by dux ex machina we will resolve all the problems, no. Because you create other problems.
Any other question?
Because in fact, an even better answer is, I can remove all of these risks if I resort back to a barter economy. Like in the Soviet Union. There was no financial stability, instability in the Soviet Union, because there was not a banking sector. It was a barter economy, it was input-output. But then you lose the possibility of investment, risk-taking, and so on and so forth.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor.
Thank you.